Good morning, Mountain View. For those of you in the parking lot, we're glad you're here. And for those of you tuning in at home, I'm so glad that you decided to join us today. You're going to see the words on your screen, and so let's just sing together this morning. We're going to praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let's just lift our hearts to heaven and praise the Lord. Let's just praise. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord forever, his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice. Exalted, the King is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise him. Our God is an awesome God, and he is greater than anything we face. So today, take courage and know he's overcome everything. He's overcome the world.
Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
If you're at home and you're enjoying that, then I pray that you enjoy this next one as we have Mike Crumley, who's going to come and sing for us. He's going to share a special song for him, so you just get ready to be very blessed with him.
Good morning, Mountain View, and our visitors that are here. I know how these preachers and musicians feel now, talking to an empty auditorium, but still yet, it's great to be here. Y'all pray for me as I sing, as we're going through times and troubles, and Brother Keith Malone's been preaching on trials, temptations, and troubles that we go through. Well, for sure, there's one anchor that holds us together, even though Sometimes we go through those temptations and trials. It's to make us stronger. So y'all pray for me as I sing "The Anchor Holds." I have journeyed through the long dark night, out on the open sea. By faith alone and sight unknown, and yet his eyes were watching me. The anchor holds, though the ship is battered. The anchor holds, though the sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I faced the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life, oh, that's where God threw his love for me. The anchor holds, though the ship though the sails are torn, I have fallen on my knees as I face the rain.
Brother. Amen. Well, hallelujah. I just want to say how glad I am that you're with us today, whether you're out in our parking lot or whether you're tuning in online on the streaming. Before I say anything else, I just want to say praise God for that anchor that does hold. I'm going to be preaching about that anchor today. How appropriate for this time that we're in, as we're in a time where a lot of doubt and confusion and turmoil. Praise God that that anchor, Jesus Christ, is still holding. And I pray that you out there in the parking lot are still just praising God by blowing those horns. And I pray that you at home are praising the Lord right there in your own living rooms or bedrooms or driving down the road, wherever it is that you're tuned in. Let me introduce myself for those that may not know me, maybe those that are visiting with us. My name's Rich Murray. I'm the pastor here at Mountain View Baptist Church. And I just want to say that if you are enjoying listening to this in our parking lot, or if you're enjoying listening to this on Facebook or YouTube, then you need to thank the Lord for Mike Crumley and for Jerry Witt, for John Pope, for Kelly. But I really just want to mention Mike and Jerry because they have put so much work. Steve Price has done a lot to help us as well, and others. But Mike and Jerry have been here day in, day out, week in, week out, to make sure that you get a good quality sound, that you can see us, that we can still be together even though we're apart. And I just praise God for them, and I thank God that He's using Mike to bring glory to Him through singing. And what a great job you did this morning, Mike. Couple of things. If you are with us as a visitor, we want to say a special welcome to you. We ask that you go onto our website and fill out our contact connection. It's over there under contacts. Just tell us who you are, what brought you our way, and maybe how that we can love on you and how we can minister to you. In ways of announcements, I know somebody told me, said, you know, just recently somebody said, you know, you don't ever really preach too long, but you give too long on announcements. And so that ought not be too much of a problem today, because basically the most announcements have to do with we don't know what's going on, so everything's just kind of on hold for the time being. Business meetings, youth outings, choir practices, team kids, vacation Bible school, in-person Sunday school, women's Bible studies, men's Bible studies, all those are on hold until further notice. I will say that we're still, as far as I know, having a deacon's meeting tonight on Zoom at 6 o'clock this evening. And we're continuing to have our Wednesday night Bible study and prayer meeting led by Keith Malone. And we've had great numbers there. If you've not been turning in, is that 6:30? Have we been doing that at 6:30 or at 7? Mike or Jerry? Keith's at 7. At 7 o'clock on Wednesday nights. Tune in and see Brother Keith on there. And I want to go ahead and just announce that Melissa Lombardo has announced that she is going to be resigning as director of our daycare. So she just wants to spend more time with the grandkids. She's had a hard time, and I've made it even harder on her in making this decision because I've just about begged her to stay. She's been so great for our church. But she just will spend time with them grandbabies, and I understand that. But with that in mind, if you know anybody who is highly qualified as a daycare director, send them our way, will you? So those are pretty much the announcements. You can find that stuff on Facebook on our website, www.mtnviewbaptist.com. You'll notice that today, instead of seeing me stand on the wagon, you're hearing me still on the radio if you're out there in the parking lot. There's a couple reasons for that. First off, we just can't get all of our musicians on the wagon. Number two, we're wearing Mike and Jerry out, running them here and there to film and to move transmitters and microphones, and it has been a little bit of a chore, and we want to try to be a blessing to them and not a burden to them. And so that's another reason why we're doing this. Hopefully, as we do get together back into our sanctuary, we'll still continue to transmit as we are now, so that those that don't feel comfortable can still listen. And you say, well, I could just listen online. You can, and some are. But, boy, there's something good about looking over and seeing your neighbor and waving at folks and still being greeted. And I want to say a thank you to Jack and Larry and our deacons and others that have been greeting people as they come in. And so, you know, we're new to all this. If you don't like what we're doing, please let us know. You don't have to be ugly, but you can still let us know what you like, what you don't like. And we'll do our best. We're trying to accommodate every soul. We want to get the gospel out to the church family. We want to preach and minister to the church family. And we want to spread the gospel to a lost and dying world. And however we can do that best is what we're going to try to do. And we're going to try to bring glory and honor to the Lord. Well, once again, that's enough talk about me and about what we're doing here at the church. I want to get on into our sermon today. I'm excited about it. It's one of those sermons that as I've prepared for it, I'm just praying that I don't say anything or do anything to mess it up. You know, if you've been around any time, that I've been preaching a sermon series called Joy in the Journey, and it's a series based out of the book of Philippians. And we are kind of right in the middle of Philippians in chapter 2. And the last time that I preached, week before last, we preached about Jesus Christ's humility. And Paul, in chapter 2, in the starting in about verse 6, he gives a poem or a hymn. There's some debate about whether or not it was actually a hymn of the early Jewish church or whether it was some of Paul's own personal poetry. But it's a beautiful picture of Christ's humiliation and His exaltation. And so we're going to be looking at the second verse of that hymn, if you will, today. And it'll be in Philippians chapter 2. So if you've got your Bibles, you may go ahead and want to start turning there, and I'll share the verses with you in just a minute. But you know, everybody has a name. Everybody has a name. My name is Rich. I shared that earlier. I'm Rich Murray. I'm the pastor at Mountain View Baptist Church. A name is how we identify people. Rich Murray is my most common name, the name that if most people ask about me, that's the name they're going to share. If the government is asking about me, they may ask about Richard Murray, Richard C. Murray, Richard Cletus Murray. I've gotten some grief over the years over my middle name being Cletus. That happens to be my dad's first name. And so that is my official name. Whenever I fill out forms, sometimes it asks for prefix. It wants to know if I'm a Mr. or a Miss or a Mrs. or a Doctor or a Reverend or several other prefixes. That gives an indication of my status or who I am. Sometimes it asks for a suffix. It wants to know if I am a junior or the third, or they want to know possibly if I have some letters that follow it that describes maybe my education, an MD or a or an EDD or a PhD or an MS or a MED, or we could go on and on with all of those. And the more names we give, the more we can identify who we are, what we are, where we've been. Now, maybe you as a child, maybe even now, maybe you didn't like the name you were given. Some of you have changed your names when you got married. You ladies have no longer the name that you once had, but you now have a different last name. And maybe as a kid you didn't like your name. Maybe your name changed over the years. When I was a kid, I was Richie. You can kind of tell how long somebody's known me by whether or not they call me Richie. If they call me Richie, they've known me a real long time. Since way back in the school days. As I got older, I dropped the IE and just became Rich. And so, you know, our names may change with our age and with our status. I remember being a little boy and I didn't like my name. I don't know why, I just didn't like it. I wanted to be named Jim. Of all names, Jim. Now, we've got a few Jims in our congregation. But I'd heard stories from my grandfather about a man in the community named Big Jim, and he seemed larger than life, and I thought that Jim had to be the coolest name ever in the world. And so I wanted to be named Jim. My brother, his name is Bill. Bill, as a from the time he was born, he was Bill. And a lot of folks would want to call him Billy, and he had no problem letting folks know that his name wasn't Billy. It was Bill. It's been Bill since the day he was born. And when he was in kindergarten, they told him that his real name was William Clarence Murray. Nobody had ever bothered to tell him that. And they told him in school that his name was William Clarence Murray. He came home crying because he didn't like that name. You know, your name tells about you. Tells a lot about you. Today we name children based on the way the name sounds. We name, maybe might have been some soap opera star that we like the sound of his name or her name, or maybe it's a name that even runs in the family, or for a host of other reasons. Maybe it was just the name that stood out to you when you bought the baby name book as you named your children. But in Bible times, much like kind of the Native Americans, people were descriptively named in the Bible days. Maybe a name was given to them that would depict the circumstances or the situations that were surrounding their birth. The name described personality and characteristics of that person. Well, today in our sermon, Paul encourages the church at Philippi by reminding them of the exalted name of the very foundation of their church and of our church, and of the church of all ages. And so with the Lord's help, I want to preach a sermon that I've entitled, A Name Like No Other. It's found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. And here's what God's Word says. For this reason, God highly exalted him and gave him a name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. May God bless the reading of His Word to your heart. Let's go to Him in prayer. Father, we thank You and we praise Your holy name as we look at Your name today. Father, we thank You that You allow us to be called by Your name. As unworthy as I am, I'm still identified by Your name, by being a Christian. And Lord, that's more significant than we ever consider sometimes. And so, Lord, I just pray that today, as I preach this sermon, You would hide me behind Your cross and that You would be glorified. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's three things in these three little verses that I want you to see about this name that is like no other. The first thing I want you to see is that it's a name that is above all names. Verse 9 starts out, says, for this reason. Well, we have to stop and ask ourselves, what is the reason? We go back to the first verse of this hymn, of this song, verses 6 through 8 that I preached on 2 weeks ago. See, Jesus' exaltation, and a matter of fact, the Bible says that he was highly exalted. That could be translated as super exalted. He was, before his super exaltation, it followed his humility. We see humility in three different ways in those earlier verses. Humility in heaven, because it says he was existing in the form of God, did not consider equality with God as something to be exploited. Here he was in heaven, and he humbled himself in heaven. He was humbled in his incarnation. But it's, verse 7 says, instead he emptied himself by assuming the form of a servant. He stepped out of heaven down to earth. He humbled himself by coming to earth and taking on the form of man. And then he humbled himself in death. Verse 8 says, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even to death on the cross. So here we see Jesus humbling himself. And for this reason, because he humbled himself, he is exalted. I want you to remember that he humbled himself. He was not humbled by Herod. He was not humbled by Pilate. He was not humbled by Caesar. He was not humbled by the Pharisees. He was not humbled by the large crowds. He was not humbled by the Roman soldiers that beat the nails into his hands and feet, or the ones that whipped him, or the ones that drove the spear into his side. He humbled himself. No one humbled him. He humbled himself. Jesus is exalted because he did that very thing. And he is actually an example of the very words that he prophesied in Matthew chapter 23, verses 11 and 12. Before he was humbled himself to the death on the cross, he told his apostles this: the greatest among you will be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled. But listen to this. Whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Jesus Christ humbled himself in a way that no other person ever has. And because of that, he is being exalted by God the Father in a way that nobody else has ever been. He was given a name, it says, that is above all other names. No other name has been exalted as Jesus was. Now, what is that name? Well, the name that the Father has given him is not specifically stated in this verse. Most scholars, however, believe that that name is the name of Lord. Now, here's what I want you to understand. Before the foundation of the world, he was God. Before the foundation of the world, he was slain for the sins of the world, the Bible says. In other words, it was as good, his resolve was as good as if it had already happened. And so he was Lord before he was crucified, and he was Lord before he was resurrected. But his position and his name as Lord and his identification as Lord was revealed to mankind after his death and resurrection. In other words, it was there for all to see that he was Lord. This word Lord is the name that's above all names. It's the word that is used in the Old Testament, in the Greek Old Testament, they see this word Lord. It is the word that is the name that is identified as God. It is the name Yahweh, God's own name. And so through his death and through his resurrection and through his humility, God has exalted him and made it revealed to all of mankind that Jesus Christ is Lord of lords. He is God himself. He is Yahweh, Jehovah God. And so he has a name that is above all other names. I want you to not only know that his name is above all other names, but it's a name that requires response. That's my second point. It's a name that requires response. It says, so that at the very name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. Folks, I want you to know that we're talking about every created being will bow their knee. You see, bowing the knee is a sign of submission. When we bow in prayer, when we kneel at an altar, we're submitting to God. We're saying, you are King, you are Lord, you are sovereign, and we're not. And we're submitting to Him, and we're submitting, and it's a sign of submission. The Bible tells us that every knee will bow. You see, God does not merely want acknowledgement. He wants allegiance. He wants you to be submissive to Him. The Bible in the book of James tells us that even the devils acknowledge, they believe that Jesus is the Son of God, but they have not submitted to Him. They are not submissive to Him until He just takes total control of them. They have not willingly, they willingly defiled Him. They willingly chose to go another way. Folks, the Bible tells us that every knee one day will bow. I'm just encouraging you to go ahead and start right now. Submit to Him. Submit to His will. Submit to His plan for you. Not only will every knee bow, but every tongue will confess. All the powers of this world will confess what this little church, this little church that was established in Philippi, this little church of misfits, this little church that was there in a enlightened, in a woke society. What this little church had claimed, that Jesus Christ is Lord, all of the world will one day proclaim that same thing. To proclaim that Jesus is Lord was offensive to the government. You see, the proper greeting of that day for Romans was to say Caesar is Lord. To say that anyone else was Lord was treason. And so, the Christians put their very lives on the line in proclaiming and confessing Jesus Christ as Lord. You can confess Him now. The Bible teaches us in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, that if you'll believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, make Him the Lord of your life. Confess Him as your master. Submit to Him, and you'll be saved. You can confess Him now as your Lord, your master, your God. And in doing so, you become part of His kingdom. You can confess Him one day. If you choose not to do that, you're going to confess Him one day in shame and embarrassment and in defeat, in a time when it will be too late to be redeemed. Some will say, well, I'll never bow my knee. I'll never confess. I'm just here to tell you, you will. The Bible's very clear that you will. You see, Jesus, the name of Jesus today requires a response from us. You may say, well, I don't have to respond to it. Well, that's a response in itself. You see, Jesus had asked His apostles, He said, who do people say that I am? And they come up with all kinds of things. Some, they said, some say you're John the Baptist. Others say you're a prophet that's come back. You're Elijah that's come back. They had all kinds of answers. But Jesus asked a very pointed question. Who do you say that I am? Who's my name to you? How do you see me? Who do you say that I am? What's my name to you? You see, there's been a lot of things said about the name of Jesus in Scripture. If you just did a search on the word name, you'll find upwards close to 1,000 references to name. There's about 230 or so in the New Testament. Now, granted, some of those deal with the names of this individual or of that individual, but particularly in the New Testament, the large majority of them deal with the name of Jesus. I want to just share, typically as I preach, I want to focus on the passage that I'm preaching on, and I want to expose that. But as Paul talks about the name of Jesus, I want to just quickly, and this is not exhaustive, not even close, but I want you to just see some of the things that are said about Jesus. First off, there's salvation in the name of Jesus. Matthew 19:29 says, "And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or children or fields because of my name will receive 100 times more and will inherit eternal life." John 1:12 says, "But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God, to those who believe in his name." One of my favorite verses in all of Scripture makes the salvation plan so simple. Romans 10:13, "For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." 1 Corinthians 6:11, it says, "And some of you used to be like this, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God." 1 John 3:23 says, "Now this is His command, that we believe in the name of His Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as He commanded us." So there's salvation in the name of Jesus. There's promises in the name of Jesus. Matthew 18:20 says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there among them." John 14:13 says, "Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son." There's folks that'll deceive in the name of Jesus. Matthew 24:5 says, "For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Messiah,' and they will deceive many." The Bible also tells of a time where people will stand and say, "Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out demons in your name?" And he'll say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Folks, there's power in the name of Jesus. We sing that in a song, but just some examples of that. Luke 10:17 says, "The 72 returned with joy, saying, 'Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name.'" James 5:14 tells us that, "Is there anyone sick among you? He should call for the elders of the church, and they are to pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord." Power in the name of Jesus. We're told in Revelation 19:13 that he wore a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Down in verse 16 of that same chapter of Revelation 19, it says, "And he has a name written on his robe and on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." The name of Jesus is worthy of worship. John 12:28 says, "Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Romans 15:9 says, "And so that Gentiles may glorify God for His mercy, as it is written, 'Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles, and I will sing praise to your name.'" Colossians 3:17, it says, "And whatever you do in word or in deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him." Hebrews 2:12 says, "Saying, 'I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. I will sing hymns to you in the congregation.'" Revelation 15:4 says, "Lord, who will not fear and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All the nations will come and worship before you because your righteous acts have been revealed." Folks, the name of Jesus ought to enlist worship from us. It ought to bring us to a place of worship. But what does that name of Jesus mean to you? If you're following Christ, I want to share some things with you. Matthew 24:9 says, "Then they'll hand you over to be persecuted, and they'll kill you, and you'll be hated by all nations because of my name." Luke 10:20 says, however, don't rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. 1 Peter 4:16 says, but if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed and let him glorify in God, having that name. Revelation 3:5 says, in the same way, the one who conquers will be dressed in white clothes, and I will never erase his name from the book of life, but will acknowledge his name before my Father and before his angels. And Revelation 20:15, and anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Folks, I'm here to tell you something. Because I've accepted his name, because I have responded, because his name requires a response, it affects my name. I have identified with him. I am now known as one of his, and I carry his name when I claim to be a Christian. And that means a change of life for me. It means that my name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That means that when one day when he opens it up, he won't see Rich Murray. He'll see the blood of Jesus Christ, and he'll see my name written in that Lamb's Book of Life. My third and final point, not only does this name require response, it's a name that brings glory to God. Here's the thing, there's no competition between God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. He has been exalted by God the Father. See, one of the verses that you may be familiar with that I didn't share is Acts chapter 4, verse 12, which says, there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to people by which we must be saved. He's been exalted to the very highest place. He's been exalted to a place that's equivalent with God. And so if you want to please God, you have to recognize and worship and submit to the name of Jesus Christ. These people that act like some other God is equivalent to the God we serve, the Muslims. They say, well, Allah, it's the same. He's the same God that you worship. No, he's not. No, he's not. Why? Because you can't bring glory to our God without Jesus Christ. If we want to bring glory to God, we must exalt and confess the name of Jesus. We must submit to him. Because he has a name that is like no other. He's Lord. The Bible is full of his names, the names that bring glory to God. His name is Jesus. That's the name Yeshua in the Hebrew. It was the name that the angel told Mary that he would be named. And so he was named Jesus and known as Jesus of Nazareth. He was known as Christ, Messiah, the promised one, the anointed one. He's known as Emmanuel, God with us. He is known by the name of Wonderful Counselor. He is known by the name Prince of Peace. He is known by the name of the Lamb of God and the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the world. He is known by the name the Suffering Servant. He is known by the name the Root of David. He is known by the name of the Lion of Judah, the Rose of Sharon, the Lily of the Valley, the Bright and Morning Star, the Rock, the Ancient of Days, the Good Shepherd, the Bread of Life, the Son of Man, the Son of God, the True Vine, the Alpha, the Omega, the Beginning, the End, the Word, the Word made flesh. And the Bible even says that he has a name that no one knows but him. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. Do you know him today? I want to ask you this question. Who is Jesus to you? That's the same question he asked his apostles. Who do you say he is? What's your response been to him? Oh, I know who he is, but I'm going to live my way, my choices, my decisions. Or have you submitted your life to him? Do you know him as the Lord of your life, the master of your life, the boss of your life, the king of your life, the very purpose of your life? Do you know him, as Mike sang earlier, the anchor that holds, that does not wave and move in the midst of storms of life? Do you know him as the Lord of your life? Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? One day when you stand before God and he opens that book, will he find your name and say, "Enter in, my good and faithful servant"? Or will he say, "Depart from me, I never knew you"? For you'll be cast into the lake of fire for eternity. For those of us that know him, this beautiful poem, this beautiful hymn, reminds us that as Jesus Christ is exalted, we too will be exalted if we'll humble ourselves as he did and humble ourselves for his cause. As we come to the close today, we're going to have just a short time of invitation. Those of you that are outside, if you'll just wait, when the song's over, I encourage you to drive by, wave at Penny and I. We're going to be on the trailer, on the wagon. We want to see you. For those of you that are home, if you need to make a decision, I encourage you to let me know. Email me, call me. Let us know what Christ has done in your life. Maybe you need to make him the Lord of your life. Today is the day for salvation. Don't wait any longer. For those that are Christians, sometimes we forget how great he is. We forget what it means to be identified as a Christian and the significance of the name that we carry. It ought to affect us, how we live, how we let others see us. Father, we thank you, we love you, and we praise your holy name. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
A decision today, make sure and let us know. Otherwise, have a wonderful day, and thank you so much for being part of our service this morning.